All right, let me get taping right now without making any other preparations or graphics or anything like that, because insight is arising, and I don't want to miss it. We're just in this amazing condition of yesterday having recognized the attempt to split the difference between mutual exclusive absolutes, recognizing that what this leads to, and really the backlash from this. It's been a tough day, it's been a tough time. It's the wow is so extreme. I didn't go to sleep till 2 in the morning. I was doing all sorts of graphics and it was quite something. And now today I feel, yes, I know something very important inside. I know this. And I was reading this website, the Dharma quotes, of all these quotes of Buddhists. And I said, you know what? This leaves me flat. I don't agree with any of it, really. Hardly any of it. Some of it seems to be pointing in a certain way, and many of it doesn't seem to just, no, this isn't it. And I said, there's something else I want to get out. I wouldn't say what they're saying. I don't agree with it exactly. I said, wow, that's interesting. But I've always felt this way. And then I went back to this realization I had yesterday. And I said, wow, this really accounts for so much. And then I said, I said something that was, people will think is blasphemous, and you know, our problem really is searching, believing we need a life. That is the delusion. This is this little island in this, trying to split the difference between 1 and 0, for instance. We find ourselves in, as if it were, trying to find a little island that we can dwell on, and we call this island life. We call this life. But in reality, there is no life. And we say, what? How could you say this? And reality doesn't have any life at all, as we define it. It's our definition of life that trips us up. We're trying to find some little haven in an abyss. The abyss of there's no splitting the difference between 1 and 0, for instance. There isn't any splitting the difference. And so when we believe that we're abiding in the realm between the two, we're really just believing in an abyss. And then we believe we need, quote unquote, a life to protect us from the abyss. And this is why we have this world, we have bodies, we all this sequentialness. We call this life. We call this time, space, process, and form. We call it life. It is not life at all. it's like a delusional imprisonment. In reality, all is absolute freedom. How can absolute freedom have a life? Nothing inherently is determinate at all in absolute freedom. There's nothing that inherently follows anything else. So you cannot speak of life at all. In the terms that we're used to speaking of life, life doesn't exist at all. It has never existed. And yet, we're frightened to even look at that. We think, oh, well, that's going to throw us into the abyss. We don't have our little island of life that protects us from this abyss. Again, there is no abyss. And so, you know, I don't hear enough of this type of talk in the world. Never have. And it's no different now than it, you know, in days gone by either, looking historically. No. There's very, very few that speak like this. Jesus spoke like this. He says, he who would gain his life would lose it. He who would lose his life would gain it. Okay, this is what Jesus is talking about. Absolutely right. You know, Jesus is one who absolutely knows the full, total, absolute truth of for us. Absolutely does, and there are others too. A few, but not, you know, the regular run of the mill person who's giving gradualist advice that be a nice person, be more compassionate, be this, that, you know, this is not the same as Jesus. Okay. Or a Longchenpa, for instance, or Ananda Maima, or Ramana Maharshi. So they absolutely know. He who would seek to gain his life, would lose it. And he who would lose his life, for my sake, Jesus said, shall gain it. Meaning for the sake of truth. Absolutely true. Absolutely true. And yet, seeing this without fear is a difficulty. We think that somehow this is a terrible, blasphemous thing to say. What do you want? Death? We look at reality as if it were death, as if it were an abyss, because we said, well, where's the sequential activity and thoughts and memories and that constitute a life? You know, there isn't any such life in reality. It transcends. Reality is not even transcends life. It's simply absolute freedom is absolute freedom. That which is perfect is always. Period. That which is perfect is always. Period. Okay, stop. Not is always something. That which is perfect is always. That which is perfect is always. That which is perfect is always. So we are so used to looking at this world and saying that this is life. Now this is a fabrication. This is a fabrication, as it were, out of fear of trying to find some refuge from the abyss. And what we think of the abyss is simply our belief that we can split the difference between truth and lies. There is no difference. One is and the other isn't. That's not a difference. It's absolutes. So there isn't any middle ground between one and zero, for instance. There is no middle ground. What's the middle ground between one and zero? There isn't any. And our mistake is to believe that there is a middle ground, which then presents itself to us then in our imagination as an abyss, total abyss, because there isn't anything, there isn't any middle ground. And yet, but by claiming that nothing is something, this is where we get the notion of an abyss, of that which is non-existent, you know, we believe it's something. Then we feel, oh, there's this dark, vast abyss, and then we say, "Oh, how can I escape this abyss?" And then that is when we get into time, space, process, and form, and what we call lives. So, what we're clinging to, we call a life. I have this life, you know. I'm in a world of life. There's not life here. There's no life anywhere. But it's like a dream. We're clinging to a dream, calling this life. What we mean is this is refuge from the abyss, imaginary abyss. But when we recognize there isn't any abyss. Is that an abyss? Recognizing there isn't any abyss, is that an abyss? No, it's not. When we say zero, we could use that to mean pure freedom. And one is the belief in fixation. Okay, what's the difference between pure freedom? How do you split the difference between pure freedom and fixation? Meaning, the one moment is the experience of one moment is inherently bound to the next moment. The next moment must reflect the previous moment, or must be like it, or you know, must there's a causation there. Okay, what's the difference between absolute freedom and causation, determinate causation? Well, the difference. Determinate causation doesn't exist. And freedom does exist. And our mistake is to think that there's some middle ground between the two. And to find out there is no middle ground, there's only freedom. How is that an abyss? How is that an abyss? It's not an abyss at all. So Longchenpa rightly points out that the problem with those who are deluded is they think the lack of delusion is an abyss. Okay, that's what they believe. So this is very, 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 very valid, true. And then Jesus is saying, he who would seek to gain his life shall lose it, and he who would lose his life for my sake shall gain it. Meaning trying to find a dwelling place in an imaginary abyss is what we call life. You will feel as if you're threatened at every which way and every angle. You never are really finding life. You're never really finding it. You're searching for it. It's almost like life. What we say life is really a search for life. a search for a place in an imaginary abyss, a search. But when we realize the abyss doesn't exist, why do we need to search within an imaginary abyss? We don't need to search. We don't need a search. But we think a search is what keeps us from the abyss. So we're searching. We say, yeah, then we call this searching a life. You know, it's just labels we've applied to this. And you have to get past the labels. Do not think what is mere label truly exists, as Longchamp puts it. So all this is arising, you know, and I just want to share it because this is not the normal way that you think that spiritual people talk like this. You say, insight, you know, we're so used to this sort of bromides of, you know, just don't get angry at people, you know. Okay. In other words, don't let your insecurities bubble over. That's not good. You're hurting other people's search as well. You know, we all got to get along here and integrate our search. So if we just integrate all our searches, somehow this will work. Nonsense. This absolute nonsense. Most of what's given out in the world as wisdom has a lot of fundamental nonsense to it. It's not coming from realization. It's just sort of, you know, folk wisdom in some ways. Has a wrong premise. You can have a wrong premise and then seek all sorts of clever ways to try and, you know, adjust to it. And some people think they found a way to adjust to it better than others. But that's just nonsense. So our true condition is not a life at all. It's not a life. It's not a sequence of thought and memory and experiencing that we sequence together and say, okay, this is this, 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 and this. That means I'm alive. It's not like that at all. I'm alive without a life at all. I don't need a life to be alive. As a matter of fact, there's nothing more unalive than having a life. I don't need a death to be alive either. A death meaning marking the end of a life. So death validates life in a way for us. We say, okay, the time prior to death, I had a life. Maybe death takes place just so we don't realize, hey, wait a minute, this is all delusion. Maybe if we live long enough, we would start saying, hey, wait a minute, let me spend some time, you know, taking a look at this. But as it is now, our situation is so busy trying to keep the body alive, and then we die, that we really don't get around to carefully, you know, looking at the truth or the truth. So maybe death is a way that we have invented to cut short our life into segments, cutting our search into segments, so we don't start getting wise about the whole situation. And again, this is just flipping the script here. We're just flipping the script. We're not worried about, is this true? Ultimately, is this true? Well, we don't have to arrive at that conclusion so much as flip the script, open your mind, get used to a different way of viewing the situation, and realize the box that we've been in, you know, is what's causing us the trouble. And I trace it back to the mind. I said the mind wanted to be greater than God. Spirit wanted to find a way to be greater than God. And the only way to do this is to claim that God is not perfect. Because how can you be better than perfection? You cannot. So my spirit believed, all spirit could do to entertain this idea was to believe there's a flaw in reality. And this flaw, you might say, would be what we say, life. So the flaw that we believe in reality is what we call life. So by our living these lives, we're witnessing to what we believe is a flaw in reality, actually. See, reality is absolute freedom. So to claim that there's a life, reality has a life, there's a life, that would be a flaw in reality. Reality is pure potentiality where any and all experiencing is available any and every instant. Without any, in other words, you're experiencing whatever you're experiencing this instant does not detract from the next instant containing all potentiality. It's never exhausted. It's never worn. It's never used up. It's never, you know, the shelves are always stocked. You know, no matter how much stock you take off the shelf, the shelves always remain perpetually stocked. You cannot exhaust reality in the slightest bit. So the so-called flaw is this, what we call life, a life, and then exhausted life, like I'm living, have been living, is again an attempt to say, well, we're exhausting the stock of reality. This is the flaw. Okay. So to claim that there's lives being lived in reality, that is the flaw that we are believing in. So, but then how do we keep from recognizing this? Well, what we do, you see, in order to maintain this ludicrous notion of a life, of lives, which is really, again, that's how we believe that reality has a flaw. Absolute freedom doesn't have a life. It is. Reality is isness. That which is perfect always is. There's no life to speak of at all, because any and everything is always open, and it's indeterminate. It's open ended. There's nothing that delineates some sort of progress or story or, you know, put together, we would call a life. This is a life story of such and such entity. There isn't any entity that is determined by experiencing whatever you're experiencing. That is somehow a product of a lack of freedom. Okay, there isn't any such identity. And just hear this. This is flipping the script in our practice. We have assertions, full stop, and the wow, flipping the script. This is a flipping the script work we're doing right here. And all you're doing is getting used to this familiarity. You might be feeling like, wow, I'm not used to hearing talk like this. This is a wow. And just full stop in the wow. Just say, okay, this is wonderful. The bell of remembrance is being rung. The bell of remembrance is being rung. And you say, yeah, this. So I get a little time here to settle into it. I don't want to just keep rampaging on with this without at least acknowledging that it's. We're not used to this sort of talk, not at all. And then again, we'll say, the ego will say, well, let's split the difference. Let's split the difference. Let's split the difference. So we have this total delusion that this flaw that we're living is a life. And then in order to keep this going, keep believing that, in order to keep believing we're greater than God, that we found a flaw in reality, how do we maintain this nonsensical self-deception by splitting the difference? We say, absolute freedom, okay, that's one option, and then determinism, boundness is the other. We claim that lives are also true, and that let me say, but absolute freedom doesn't agree that lives are that's true, and lives don't believe that absolute freedom is true. And we think, well, what do we do? And then we think that we come up with the answer. Oh, it's a very benevolent you know, enlightened answer, say, well, we'll split the difference. Let's split the difference. And then, okay, this is a defense. It's to keep this kooky notion of a flaw in reality. We then split the difference. We think we split the difference. But what arises in our mind from splitting the difference is what we term an abyss. And from that abyss, we then well, we don't have to nail it down. We're just laying. This is layout we're doing right here. But what arises is this imaginary abyss. And then in this imaginary abyss, we say, oh my gosh, this is terrifying. Where can I find refuge? Okay. And so that's what gives us what we would say this purposeful activity of our lives. And then we think our lives are a matter of we're seeking stability. We say, wow, our lives are very unstable. Our lives are very threatened. And yet, we feel as though we can fashion some existence within this abyss, as it were. And so we feel very, well, I'm just working this through now. We don't have to nail it down. That's okay. So this idea of determinism gets played out in this, what we call lives, body, world, etc. And the splitting the difference is we think that reality, the abyss represents reality. And these lives that we're living in this abyss represent determinism. I mean, so the abyss represents absolute freedom, and our lives represent lack of absolute freedom, the flaw in reality. And so then we think that living our lives in this world and in this time, space, process, form, this universe, that this constitutes the compromise, the splitting the differenceness. And so we think that this is the best that we can do, that this is fair, that this is right, that this is just. And we can't understand why God doesn't accept our compromise. And in fact, we pretend that God does accept it, that God is all is smiling at us in the benevolence of this compromise, saying, oh, yeah, okay, God's saying. And we think that God is saying, oh, great, that's a good deal for me too. You know, I don't want to admit that I have a flaw. And so the Son of God has very graciously decided to cover this flaw up by living a life in the abyss, and it's a good deal for me. You know, it's like we've made it. We've offered God a good deal here, splitting the difference. So to even look at all this like this, look at the layout of it, etc., one has to be relaxed and calm and not frightened or bothered by this. And that takes a lot of familiarity, especially not to be intimidated by those who call themselves spiritual teachers, etc., who are not saying this. Because we think that we found the answer is this split the difference, and that this is our new being here as a body, a person in a world, and living a life, having our life, and we need to learn to live our life to the maximum, enjoy it as much as possible. We think that that's the answer. Just appreciate the moment. Appreciate, your living. Appreciate your life. God has given you this life, we say, and appreciate it. God doesn't give a life to anything. God gives eternal life to all, inherently. The only life there is eternal life. This is what Jesus tells us, rightfully so. The only life there is eternal life. That which is not eternal life is not any life at all, actually. And since we're so used to talking in terms of the way we view life, the way we talk about it, you might say that there's only absolute freedom and not any life at all. Absolute freedom is a complete rejection of the whole notion of life that we have. There is no difference. You can't split the difference between mutual exclusive absolutes. There is no difference to split. Zero difference to split. How do you split zero? That's another way of looking at it. Let's look at it this way. How do we split zero? Well, we think we found a way. We have not found a way. We're still actually holding on to the belief in flawed reality. And we think, well, reality is only partially flawed. And we're able to deal with that. Only partially flawed, you know? Yeah. That's like splitting zero. How do you split zero? There's no determinacy. There's zero determinancy. Reality is not a situation of determinacy at all. We never lose our freedom, our absolute freedom. Whatever experiencing we've gone through, in no way does that determine our experiencing going forward, so to speak. Our subsequent experiencing. In no way is it determinate in the slightest bit. So how can we speak of life then? How can we call that life? Right? We view life as something which has some aspect of determinacy to it. In no way is it eternal life has any determinacy in it whatsoever. It's zero determinacy. So how can you split zero? The ego says, no problem. We'll split the difference between determinancy and no determinancy. There's zero determinancy. So the notion of determinancy is zero. How do you split zero? Well, you split zero. That's where this idea of an abyss comes in. Subject and object, that we feel this oceanic abyss feeling and get all frightened and say the way to protect myself from it is to have a life, is determinacy. I can say I know where I've been and I know and this determines where I'm going, so I'm not in an abyss, you know. So we're protecting ourselves from reality by imagining that we're a life in an abyss, that we're a determinacy in abyss. Again, we're just laying it out here. Don't think you need to find some conclusion to this. Remember, what we are dealing with here is our familiarity. The issue of familiarity is what trips everyone up. If it weren't for this, if it weren't for the continuity fear, we would get this like that. We would immediately see it and dismiss the whole thing, of course. I get it just like that. And no more imaginary abyss. Can't split zero. There's nothing there to split. There's no determinacy to split. Zero determinancy. I heard some footsteps. I hear footsteps. Zero determinancy is not a quantity, is not something that's splittable. It's not like you have half of zero. Say, okay, I'll give you half a zero, and I'll keep this half of zero, and we'll call it good. You And yet this is what we're doing. We're thinking, God, I got a great deal for you. You say that there's zero determinancy, and I say there is determinancy. And so I'll tell you what, we'll take your zero and we'll split that. You know, we'll split the zero to zeroness. There'll be some determinancy and also no determinancy. There'll be no determinancy and also determinancy, and we'll call that good. What? What kind of deal is that? Well, the old determinancy says, well, at least I acknowledge that there's also no determinancy. Well, if you acknowledge that there's no determinancy and also claim that there is determinancy and claim you're now dwelling in a new reality, which where both are true, then this is a mental abyss that you're believing in. You're believing that zero is some sort of quantity, as it were. There's a condition called half of zero, and we're abiding in this half of zero, which we see as an abyss. And but our experiencing of the abyss is the other half, so to speak. So not only is it an abyss, we're experiencing the abyss. Like, oh my gosh, I am experiencing half of zero. But I feel like I don't exist. So I need a life to prove I exist. I need a determinancy here to get rid of this feeling like I don't exist. Of course, if we're trying to exist in half of zero, instead of seeing zero as zero and just accepting that there isn't any way to split zero, we believe that we can dwell in half of zero. But the price of that is this abyss feeling of a subject object. I'm being swallowed by the abyss. How do I prevent being swallowed by abyss? Oh, I have a life. So we have just manufactured. We've imagined these forms and we call this life. So that we identify, our mind identifies with this mechanism we call nature, which presents these mechanisms we call form or life forms. So we can feel like there's this place I can go to escape the abyss, and yet it's like identifying with a mirage. Okay, actually, it's like in a dream. You know, you're in this desert, this abyss of sand, and you say, I got to escape this. And then you see, oh my gosh, look at that lake and water and palm trees. Oh, it's so wonderful. And I got to get there. And so you're going there, and you feel not so frightened by the abyss of sand. You know, you say, oh yeah, I know, but I'm getting free of that now because I see the oasis is there. And so you go towards it. But it keeps moving. You know, you think, well, I've been going toward it for a long time and still all I see is sand, but right ahead of me is this mirage. So we identify with that we're closing in on getting life here. We're closing in. The world is like a mirage, and these body forms are called life forms are like a mirage that we're trying to identify with it. To protect us from this abyss, and yet we never actually can identify with it enough. It's like a mirage, chasing a mirage. And a lot of the various now, some of the wisdom teachings just say, "Hey, look, you know, it's a mirage. You're not going to be ever satisfied with it. Just kind of accept that it's temporary." And, you know, okay, well, as far as that goes, if they follow up on that, then that can work, sure. But just as a snippet of information, that really doesn't help us much. What we're afraid of is that we've never been able to identify with any of this accurately. Just like in a mirage, we've never been able to reach the oasis. You know, it keeps receding from us. And then we think, and so a lot of the so-called wisdom is not really wisdom, is we imagine someone in the desert and there's a mirage there, okay? So then they sit down and say, okay, now, how do I get to that oasis. How can I get there? And they say, the faster I run towards it, the more it recedes from me. They say, this is weird. Okay, so let me just sit down and not run after it. And maybe then, okay, at least I kept the mirage from moving. So we say, okay, the mirage isn't moving anymore. So I made progress. Okay, so now it's fixated. But now how do I, you know, and then we thinking like, oh, what do I do now? Well, and we console ourselves. Well, at least the mirage isn't, it's not moving away from me anymore. So that's progress. I mean, and we try to just say, okay, that's good. And let me be satisfied with that. At least it's close. At least I'm close. And it's not running away anymore. Hey, let's call that good. Or they call out to the mirage. Let me see if I can, you know, talk to the mirage. Hey, mirage, you know, hey, oasis, I'm here. You see where I am? Can you please come to me? Can you come to me? And they think, I can't, if I can't get to the oasis, maybe I can get the oasis to come to me. And so we pray to the oasis. Oasis, you're so wonderful. I love you so much. I'm worshiping you. I adore you. I need you so much. What do I need to do? And then we think, well, maybe I'll you know, maybe the oasis is mad at me. That's why it's running away or afraid of me or something. Say, you know, let me sacrifice my precious things. Say, look, oasis, you're the most precious of all. And let me sacrifice what's precious to me to prove to you that you're so sacred, so precious to me. You won't keep running away from me. You'll come to me, or at least you won't. When I come to you, you won't run away. And we try to appease it. We try to appease it like this. And so all these religions, rituals, and beliefs and stuff arise from this basic dilemma that we have, is we can't actually identify with. We're trying to identify with these body forms, body mind forms that we have imagined. And it's like a mirage. We can never do it. So we're trying to figure out a way here. Now, as long as we don't see the fundamental premise behind what's going on, we're stuck in this. And we, our whole thought, our whole attention is on that mirage of an oasis, saying, how can I get on its good side here? How can I get it to keep fleeing away from me? You know, it must be something wrong with me. Hey, oasis, what's wrong with me? And it doesn't seem to answer, but we imagine, so well, I got to, well, maybe it's this. We say, let me work on this. Oasis, you're so beautiful. I love you so much. Don't run away from me. Maybe I'm a bad person. I'm bad, so I need to practice some sort of austerities. Or maybe, you know, I want it too much and it's afraid of that. So let me pretend I don't want it. Let me concentrate. I got to concentrate on it. If I just concentrate my mental concentration enough, then I can fixate it. It won't move. So let me believe in fixation. Let me have a power of fixation over it, so then it will stay put. You know. So much. There's really an endless variety of tactics that we can dream up to try and prevent that mirage from moving away from us. And this is the situation we're in. We're like in this endless desert, and there's this mirage, and we're trying to get to it. I mean, reaching identity with what we call a life. And we can never identify with a life because we're imagining the whole thing in the first place. And it's based on the belief that in splitting zero. And that the belief that we make a deal with reality, saying, okay, reality, we'll split the difference. We'll just agree that reality is both indeterminate and determinate. He'll say, you know, we'll split the difference. It's both free, absolutely free, and not absolutely free. And we think that we've, you know, solved the problem, except there's this abyss. You know, we haven't quite solved that problem. And we think we solved that problem by getting to that oasis. How do we get to that oasis? And we make beautiful music. That's another way we do. Oh, yes, we sing songs to the oasis. Make beautiful. Say, hey, oasis, don't you want to come a little closer? I mean, look how beautiful I can sing. What a beautiful song I can sing for you. And or maybe I can sneak up on I'm just playing this song. Don't you want to hear the song? If you run away, you won't hear the song. You know, we try to make beautiful music for it. We try to creep up on it, or just gradually, or we try to, you know, just tactics after tactics after tactics. Our whole life is consumed with these tactics that we're using. Quote unquote life, our attention is consumed with these tactics. And of course, we don't want to admit that we're using any tactics because we think the oasis will say, oh, they're trying to trick me. You know, they're trying to capture me and trick me. They're using tactics, so we say no. We're not trying to get any closer or do anything like that. But all the while we're desperate. Say, oasis, please don't move away any further. I'm so scared of this abyss. I'm surrounded by an abyss. This is the terrible dream that we're having. This awful nightmare of a dream. Now, how do we resolve the dream? Do we resolve it by finally reaching the oasis? No. We resolve it by the desert disappearing, actually. The abyss disappearing. If there's no abyss, there's no fear. We don't need to identify with any time, space, process, or form. We don't need any refuge from a non-existent desert, do we? It's like, how do we solve the problems that arise in a dream by waking up from the dream? So in our dream of splitting the difference between truth and lies, truth appears as this vast abyss to us that threatens to extinguish our determinacy. I mean, of course, if you believe that your identity is something determinate, then reality would seem to be out to annihilate this and has to be protected against at all cost. But keep in mind that this all is based on not on our desire for some, you know, life identity or something, but our desire to find a flaw in God so we can be greater than God. That's the whole origin of all this. This is what's really going on. So we're just doing this layout here. The more familiar you get with this layout, the better it will go. This is very heavy layout here that we're talking about. But if you're able to, you know, well, like I said, getting familiar with this and overcoming the wow, letting the wow, you know, settle down. Don't overcome it. Just let it settle down. It will be with you, and you'll get some pushback for sure. See, we always take whatever remedy, whatever wisdom we get, and think that we can use that to get closer to that oasis. This is obviously doesn't work. That's why I say when you get this information, full stop in the wow. It's like, wow. I don't have to get I don't have to get to that oasis. Meaning, I don't have to identify with body minds. Because our identification never seems to be real to us. Why? Because we're absolutely free. So how can identity seem real to us? identity of time, space, process, and form, how can we ever feel that is real to us or secure? We can never feel that way. It's impossible, because we're absolutely free. We can never feel that we're not absolutely free. We can never feel as if there's actual some fixation there to identify with, because there isn't. So we can never get to that mirage of self-identity. As Jesus says, reality is there's only one self. There's only one self-identity, the allness of eternal life, as it were. It's all just one. So there's no individual self-identity at all. There's no such thing as self-identity as we look at it. So what we are, spirit, can never feel as though it's attained self-identity. And it always feels that it's about, that it's, it doesn't quite have a hold on it. Doesn't have a hold on it. In other words, the oasis is like a mirage. It's just out of reach. Just out of reach. And every time I try to step into it, it moves on me. And I can never stay. So when we hear this sort of spiritual clarification and then try to turn that into a technique to get to that mirage, obviously we're spinning our wheels. So full stop in the wow is essential to not spin your wheels. Don't spin your wheels. Don't try to reach a life. Don't try to get a life. Don't try to find a life. Don't try to get self-identity. Just rest in this wow. Like, wow, maybe I don't need to. Maybe I don't need to... Maybe this void isn't real either. Maybe both are unreal. Maybe both the mirage, the oasis, and the desert are both equally unreal. Maybe I'm abiding in absolute fullness this very instant. The opposite of an abyss. You see, reality is we can say it's opposite because we're imagining an abyss, but it's what you'd say is absolute, perpetual fullness. No gap whatsoever. No lack whatsoever. Total, eternal sufficiency, and again, this is not a technique to be applied. Truth is not a technique to be applied. Neither neither samsara nor nirvana exist. In this dream, we talked about the abyss and the oasis. The oasis would represent samsara of body mind activity. That we're dreaming this up and then trying to identify with this, and the desert would signify the abyss, that like a desert abyss of sand, just endless abyss of sand. That would be nirvana. So one of the things we try to do is we think, we thought I can't ever reach that mirage. It keeps moving on me. And we say, wait a minute, okay, what we need to do then is to be happy with the desert. Let's turn our backs on the oasis there, and let's just say, desert, I'm happy with you. I'm not chasing after anything anymore. I'm just sitting here quietly. I'm just sitting and not chasing after the mirage, but I'm embracing the void, the abyss. We try that technique, and that you might say is nirvana, the absence of motion, but it's still a dream of motion and non-motion, to identify with, a dream of identification. So both samsara and nirvana represent the two sides of one coin of the dream of identification, or a dream of splitting zero. So we're not trying to attain a state of concentration, some sort of technique. Now, it's our delusion that we can split zero, that makes us think that zero has some identity to it that we have to account for. And if we stop splitting it, somehow we'll be stuck with full zero, you know. This is, ridiculous. Zero simply means there's no such thing as determinacy. So there isn't half of zero, never has been, and there isn't zero as some identity or some experiencing at all. It's not like I'm experiencing zero determinancy. It's not like that. It's that I'm experiencing isness. You can't experience zero. Zeroness, as it were. So, it's hardly something to be avoided. Right? It's like, oh, I got to avoid experiencing zero. You know, wow, that would be terrible. I could experience zero, that would be terrible. Now, there isn't any such experience. Absolute freedom, it's not like it says I'm experiencing zero determinancy here. It's not like that. There isn't any determinancy to experience. When you say zero determinancy, using words and labels, we automatically think, well, okay, I'm it exists, but I'm just experiencing zero of it. It's not like that. And yet we're so accustomed to believing that we can split the difference, split zero. We assume that zero has some sort of identity to it, as it were. There's something there. Otherwise, how could we split it? When we say there's no difference between this and that, what we're saying is there is no that at all. So how could we find a difference between this and this? There's only this. So how can we find a difference between this and this? There isn't any difference to be found. That which is itself, that which is not something to be referenced as something that we compare. Cannot be compared to itself, as it were. It's like I'm comparing this and this. You cannot compare this and this. So we're still stuck in the belief we're comparing this and that. We compare this and there's a that, and we're comparing this and that. And techniques involved with how to emphasize one or the other or combine the two or something. But really, there is no that. So there is no comparing. We say truth is incomparable, beyond compare. Absolutely, it's beyond compare. There's no possibility that of comparing. So, when we have healed perception, we feel we're beyond compare. We're experiencing this which is beyond compare. It's not this in comparison to that. There's only this. I am this. I am this, and that is there is nothing to compare, nothing else to compare. There isn't any that. That meaning determinancy. There's only absolute freedom. This meaning absolute freedom. I am this. That's all that can be said about it. Or whatever word you want to use, it's just, you know, there isn't any comparison. You want to say, I am that, as Nisargadatta Maharaj, I am that. this is the same sort of statement. I mean, I am the isness. Whether you say it's this or it's that, it's just a mere label. I am suchness. I am isness. I am original nature. There isn't anything to compare. You can't compare original nature with original nature. How can you compare a thing with itself? This is our delusion. We think that we found a way. We haven't found a way. When we say thing in itself, you know, we're saying, how can we when we see everything as it is, we're realizing that you can't compare what is with itself. You cannot compare. And we're free then of this terrible delusion. So again, we do layout here. We're doing this layout, flipping the scriptness here. This is a flipping your script type of video, which helps move us back towards assertion. But coming off the last video, which was so intense, this enormous breakthrough. So now the wow is so strong. What I'm doing now is flipping the script, so I can get back to, you know, some focused assertions here. That will come. So we're trying, you can't compare a thing with itself. So we're trying to compare things with like things. And thinking that this is giving us a comparison. We're comparing isness, this with that. Splitting zero. Again, just doing layout, looking at the layout. We don't have to nail it all down. That will happen. It might even happen just spontaneously, you know, just very, I've seen that somehow it just resolves like that. Oh, yeah. But the wow is very intense right now. We've gotten into, you know, tremendous focus here. How do you compare something with itself, as it were? How do you compare isness with itself? Okay, don't nail it down. Just let the wow be there. Let the wow be there. In other words, get comfortable with it. That's more important than trying to nail it down. Because basically, we've just wandered into a territory which is extremely profound. And we know it. And so it's good to take assess where you're at and say, wow. You know, don't rush the enlightenment. Don't try to rush it. You know, don't try to force it. Don't try to force it. we've been trying to compare a thing with itself and claiming, yeah, of course you can compare a thing with itself, and then we'll split the difference between the two. the truth lies somewhere in between. It's like the truth that lies in between isness and isness. We're comparing this with itself and calling it this and that, and then we'll make a deal and we'll settle for split the difference between the two. Of course, there isn't any difference between this and this. So what can you split? You have to believe in an abyss. And then seek shelter, seek some sort of stability in that abyss. So this is the kind of teaching that I've always wanted to hear, so I'm having to do it myself. I can't find it anywhere, really. Not laid out, doing the layout like this. So this is just what I've always wanted to hear. I've always known this within, but I couldn't hear it in the world. Where's the layout? You know, I just couldn't find it. So just have to do it, you know, go ahead and do it. It's like saying, "Well, what's the difference between absolute freedom and absolute freedom?" We'll split the difference. Yeah, I'm splitting the difference between absolute freedom and absolute freedom, and that's where I'm dwelling now. Don't worry about nailing it down. Full stop in the wow. You're not nailing it down. You're just saying, wow. It's like really inside, you're probably trembling. I feel like I'm trembling inside. This is just wow. Now we don't feel we're really experiencing because we're trying to compare everything with itself and then split the difference and identify with that. It's like we're identifying with a mental construct that has no basis in reality whatsoever. It's a mirage. So when we're trying to compare something with itself, then we don't see anything as it is, as it were, because we think we're seeing both what it is and what it isn't. Something different. Something comparable. Just doing the layout, flipping the script is like doing a layout and just sort of brainstorming here. Don't worry about nailing it down. Remember, how do you nail down familiarity? You can't really nail it down. it's like choreographing like a dance step or something, and you go through it slow motion, you do like this, you try out various stuff and you choreograph it, and eventually then you can dance it because you've sort of done the layout. We're getting used to looking at it this way, from this perspective, you know, and the more we get used to it, the easier it is. If we see everything as it is, we say, okay, great, that's, we're seeing it as it is, but now how do I compare it to itself so I can have an identity, find an identity? How do I get rid of the abyss? Well, there isn't any abyss. There isn't any identity. There's not an identity based on isness, being compared to isness. Splitting the difference between isness and isness. Freedom doesn't have an identity other than freedom. It's like the ego saying, okay, well, what's the difference between this and this? I don't understand. Like, I can't quite understand the difference. There isn't any comparison. You can't compare something with itself. You can't compare. That's not a comparison. So there really isn't any comparison to be found anywhere. In reality, there isn't any comparison at all. Everything is each moment. And what we call life is this idea of comparison, comparing it, that this claim there's a difference. And we think we lose our life, is that we're losing all our experience of comparison. If we experience everything as it is right now, we think we'll lose our life, which is what we think is life. It's this new deal we've fashioned. So we'll say, oh, I need my life. I need my comparisons here. So how do I feel when I look at this? It's like, like I feel, wow. Like, or wow. Wow. This is really true. This is just great. Wow. This really does shed light on this farce, you know, that engage in this farce. We think we need a self to compare with the self, as it were. And if we don't have a comparison with the self, then we don't have any self. It's as if nothing exists unless we can compare with itself. That comparing something with itself constitutes life, we believe. So now, as long as we take this as a wow, we feel comfortable, we feel okay. As soon as we say that's weird, then we start thinking and asking questions, and we flip into the, we call it, you know, you want to call it left-mindedness or whatever you want to call it, but non-abstraction, as it were. But we start getting fear, we go into fear. But no, we just stay in the wow mode. We don't need to ask questions. I mean, we're just like shining a light. So I can see it. So all I got to do is turn on this light. I can see it. Oh, wow. I don't have to ask any questions. I can see it. And I know the only reason I don't turn on this, keep this light on all the time, is the continuity fear. That's all. So the more time I spend with the light on, the closer I get to having it on all the time. And of course, the whole notion of turning off the light is the belief in comparison. So, well, I need to compare having the light on and having the light off. Otherwise, I don't have a life. Believing that the comparison is life. Comparing what is with what is, we believe that's a life. That's life. Come up with light and dark, then, you know, comparison. We've got to compare the two. We say, well, one is, and then the other is the comparison, is being compared with itself, which is this. Which generates this void, as it were, darkness. It doesn't generate it. It just we can't account for it any other way. In our imagination, we symbolize it. But there isn't anything to symbolize. You can't. How can you compare anything with itself? They say, well, you've seen the original nature of everything. Oh, it's the incomparable nature. Reality is incomparable. All is incomparable. Now, there's an assertion. Yes, I already know that all is incomparable. Yes, I already know that all is incomparable. How are we doing here? Great. 112 is doing well. Yes, I already know that all is incomparable. Yes, I already know that there's no comparison. No comparisons can ever be made with what is. Yes, I already know that isness is incomparable. Yes, I already know there's no identity based on comparison. There is no comparison. There's zero comparison. Philosophy, well, I don't want to get into that. That's a swamp. Forget the swamp. We won't even worry about that. We see very clearly what the situation is. This question is, how do we keep the light on? Well, stop believing we need to compare the light with being on and the light being off. The light being off would just be a belief in comparison. So I got to keep my identity. I got to compare. My identity is the determination of this comparison. How does it compare? And we never can quite come up with an answer. So we feel like we don't quite have our identity yet. We're still forming our identity as we keep, you know, going through the so-called comparisons. It's like, how does this compare with itself? Well, I can't quite, you know, haven't quite grasped it yet. Not quite there. So I haven't quite established an identity. I'm working on it. That's what we call our life. I'm working on establishing an identity. Because there's this void. I feel like this it's like this void is chasing me, because I can't, you know, but I know I just got to get the answer. As soon as I get the answer, then I'll have an identity and I'll be safe from the void. So how do things compare with themselves? And we think, yeah, there's got to be an answer. I'm on high-speed pursuit of finding this answer. And we think not finding the answer, it means we're swallowed by the void. Swallowed by the void. just doing the layout. Don't struggle for a conclusion, an answer. That would be, you know, identity. You think, oh, I found it. Our identity is not based on finding the comparison between truth and lies. There's no identity to be found there. There's nothing to be found there. There isn't any comparison. Everything is. That's all. That's all that there is. Just isness. That there's nothing to compare with isness. And it's not like we say, okay, well, how does nothing compare with isness? You know, no, that nothing means that there isn't anything other than isness. So that there isn't any way to draw any comparison. There isn't any way to draw a comparison. Don't try to reach a conclusion. Just wow. Let the wow. Be permeated with the wow. Be permeated with the wow. I have to go in and I have to go get dinner at some point here, so that's fine. Watch a little baseball as I get the dinner. This is again, the wow is just tremendous, but not too much. Yeah, again, just familiarity with all of this is what's important, and just full stop in the wow. Later on, once we get used to this, then it'll be easy to shine the light on it even stronger and even leave the light on all the time. You know, to answer the question, well, how do we leave the light on all the time? Getting used to the light being on as much as possible and ultimately realizing we don't need to compare. We don't need an identity based on comparison, so just leave it on all the time instead of like believing that it's dark now, so let's compare the difference between the dark and the light, you know, and I have an identity based on comparison. Just leave it on all the time. I mean, what's the secret to leaving it on all the time? Leaving it on all the time, not trying to compare it. Leaving the light of clarity on all the time is we realize no, there isn't any, you know, comparison is impossible. I don't need an identity based on comparison. I already have everything just as it is. And, don't have to force it. We'll just. We feel relaxed and comfortable. The more we get familiar, the more it's just like, you know, what's the big deal? This isn't difficult. I'm not doing something difficult. You know, those who, you know, don't take the familiarity into account, think that there's some magical trick to it or some, you know, some really difficult, you did something difficult, but it's not like that. It's that you just keep going until you feel that this is easy, this is no trouble at all, this doesn't trouble me, I'm not afraid of this. Practice, 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 full stop in the wow. That is remaining engaged with this spiritual consideration, spiritual inquiry, this flipping the script, assertion, full stop on the wow, remaining engaged with the spiritual practice is how you evaporate the continuity fear, how you become comfortable, how you become familiar with this. Then the insights will arise. Once you really feel familiar, then inspiration will just arise. You'll say, wow, I can really shine the light so brightly and not have to turn it off. So it's like that. When we're in the wow, don't try to find some secret. Just say, no, let me just get used to this. This has been an earful. You know, this has really been something. And it certainly has for me too. So I'm going to stop the video now. Upload it so you can watch it and hear this. And again, just stay patient with this familiarization. Stay patient with this familiarization. Obviously, what we're talking about is very profound. So don't worry. You say, well, I didn't nail it down. No, don't worry about nailing it down. Just get familiar with it. And that will be plenty. Plenty of, you know, tremendous work having done. Tremendous. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.